Now, for more on Spain's big win at the Women's World Cup and the highlights of the tournament, let's speak with James Walton. He is Sports Business Group Leader at Deloitte Southeast Asia. James, welcome to the program. Now, Spain crowned champions in Sydney Stadium, Australia. First off, your reactions. How much of a win was this for Spain, given the issues they faced prior to the tournament? You know, we had players quitting the national team in protest against the coach and the Spanish Football Federation, and some of them cited mental health concerns as well.
Yeah, it's a massive win. I have to say, first, as an Englishman, obviously it's a little bit disappointing, but Spain really deserved their win. And it's interesting that going into the tournament, actually both of these teams were perhaps downplaying expectations a little bit. England had a number of players missing throughout the tournament due to injury. Spain, of course, had the issues with 15 of their players effectively refusing in the last couple of years to play for the team as a result of their feelings around the treatment by the coach. As it was, several of them declared themselves eligible to play in the end, but it was still very definitely a weakened team. And the fact that they were able to do this, to go and win this World Cup in the face of all that, shows the strength and depth of Spanish women's football right now and the emergence of the players that they have, including some of the very best players in the world, like Putellas and others. But it also perhaps will make for an interesting next couple of weeks as we see how things play out in that ongoing controversy and whether the Spanish FA decides to back the coach who has just won the World Cup, after all, and whether or not the female players decide to take further action as a result.
Yeah, and I also want to talk about Australia's performance. It secured a fourth-place finish, losing out to Sweden for the bronze medal. I mean, they definitely captured the hearts of the nation. We have Prime Minister Anthony Albanese promising $200 million for women's sport after that. Do you see this World Cup as a success for Australia as a host nation?
Yeah, it's been one of the wonderful things about women's sports tournaments in recent years. We saw it with the previous Women's World Cup and in Europe and the European Championship. It seems to suddenly shine a light on an area that perhaps politicians and the general public were not really thinking about. And it's like suddenly they see that the women's teams can be just as successful as the men's, if not more so. And that they see the level of fan engagement, they see the level of impact on getting young people, particularly young girls in this case, to participate in the sport, and suddenly realize they've been neglecting these areas. So hopefully this messaging will continue, and not only Australia, but other nations who have seen such strong showings at this World Cup, for example, Nigeria, Colombia, will also make further investments to try to lift up women's sport and women's football.
Yeah, and it's not just the Matildas achieving their best result at the tournament. We have other Asian teams enjoying some success as well. Japan reaching the quarterfinals. The Philippines in their first World Cup had a historic win over New Zealand. So what does this, all of this mean for women's football?
Well, I think what it means is that the bar is being raised. That we've gone from a situation, if you go back even as recently as 4 years ago, where you still had the U.S. appearing in every final, and there had not been a World Cup final without the US or Germany in it since the tournament started. And it looks like the other nations have started to catch up. The playing field has definitely been leveled a bit. It's gone from the days where if you were a professional women's footballer, you had to play in the US to where you can now play in Spain, in Germany, in France, in the UK, and in other nations, and where the pay is actually encouraging women to take this up as a professional career instead of as a part-time on the side of your normal job. And all of that has to be good for women's football. So hopefully we will see by the time we get to the next World Cup that it will become even more competitive and that this resurgence will continue.
So it's definitely on an upwards trajectory there, given the funding and support devoted especially to this World Cup. But I suppose sustaining them will always be an issue, right? Do you reckon we still have a long way more to go?
Oh, there's definitely still a long way to go. We saw several nations, Jamaica, Nigeria, South Africa, where the players had pay disputes coming into the tournament around, you know, basic things like not even being paid or what they were getting. We're still seeing significantly more investment in the men's game. sponsors are gradually warming up. But for example, in selling the media rights for this tournament, FIFA was struggling in some countries to even get 5% of what those same countries were paying for the media rights, for the broadcast rights, for the Men's World Cup. And that is such a huge disparity. But hopefully, again, the exposure, we had over 2 billion viewers watching the games around the world, over 2 million spectators in the stadium this time. Hopefully, those kind of numbers will make people sit up and take notice. The country's TV broadcasters will decide that it's worth buying the rights. Sponsors, advertisers will come in and support. And that will in turn obviously mean that prize money can increase. It will mean the wages paid to the players, as well as the facilities and the support that is available to them will increase as well. So hopefully this is just the beginning, but it will require a sustained focus. And the kind of investment Australia is making is really just a first step.
All right. Thanks, James. James Walton, the sports business group leader at Deloitte Southeast Asia.